That sounds great. So I'm very happy to introduce Jenn Gardy today. Jenn earned a bachelor's in biology from the University of British Columbia, and then a PhD in biochemistry from Simon Fraser University. She then spent her first career, I guess, more like 10 years at the British Columbia Center for Disease Control and the University of British Columbia School of Public Health. And while there, she was really one of the proponents of using genomics as a tool to understand pathogen transmission dynamics. And she continues to be like a proponent and an advocate for pathogen genomics. And she applied them to multiple applications. But really, I mean, I do remember some of the landmark studies that they did in tuberculosis, where they combined genomics and social networks to characterize outbreaks, and really those were some of those first applications. Then more recently, since 2019, she joined the Gates Foundation, the malaria team, as the Deputy Director of Surveillance Data and Epidemiology, and that's where she is now. And I think that's through this position is that at the EPPIcenter, we've had like more opportunities to interact with her. If that's not enough, she's a very active science communicator, and I wasn't aware of this, but now I know that she hosted several episodes of a show called The Nature of Things, which was broadcasted nationally in Canada. She also writes children's science books, and her latest book is called It Take Guts, How Your Body Turns Food into Fuel and Poop, and it was published in September of this year, and she's also an avid mushroom hunter. And a final thing is that, well, this week she was elected as an international member of the National Academy of Medicine. So congratulations for that, Jenn. And we're very, very happy to have you join us today.
Thank you so much, Isabel. And thank you for the invitation. Teresa said I can come mushroom hunting with y'all anytime I'm visiting the area. I'm completely going to take you up on that. So I'm going to pop my slideshow up onto the screen here. Boom. There we go. Today's presentation is all about an area that a few of us have been talking about for a while now, something that I like to refer to as digital pathogen surveillance, which is really sort of the unity of digital epidemiology, genomic epidemiology, all wrapped up with a One Health bow on top, and represents what I think is an interesting new potential paradigm for making sure the next infectious disease outbreak doesn't become the next pandemic. If you're interested in connecting with me at any point, you can find me on Twitter at Jennifer Gardy. I'm usually pretty active on there. Today I was making fun of Eric Feigl Ding for not knowing that TB was airborne. So join me over there if you like stuff like that. As Isabel mentioned in her introduction, I do work at the Gates Foundation now. I've been there almost 3 years. And my role on the malaria team there is leading a portfolio that focuses on strategy investment in really three areas. Surveillance, ensuring that malaria endemic countries have good functioning, high quality surveillance systems, molecular surveillance, so using genetic and genomic data from both the parasite and the vector as a source of information, and also all things sort of related to math modeling. So that's what I do today, and that is the context that I know many of you in. But what I'm going to talk about in today's presentation is work that I did in my previous pre-foundation life, where I worked in this lovely building rendered in delightful watercolor. This is the British Columbia Center for Disease Control. It's in Vancouver, Canada, so a couple hours north of you by plane. And it is basically the provincial CDC for British Columbia, but it's also an academic center as well. So all of us that were staff scientists had university appointments as well. And we did what I would describe as applied or translational research. We were working with patient samples. We were working with patient data. We were answering questions that had immediate impact and influence when it came to public health program decision making and policy making. But at the same time, we were also exploring some very, very new frontiers. So the work that I'll talk about today and the ideas that I'm going to share with you really did all come out of that time. And if you're interested in what I have to say today and you want to print it out and sleep with it under your pillow, a lot of what I'll talk about today was laid out in an article that Nick Lohman and I wrote. I think it came out in 2017 now in Nature Reviews Microbiology or Genetics, one of those Nature Reviews journals. And it's sort of the culmination of some thinking that we've been doing really over the previous, I guess at that point, 8 years of working in pathogen genomic epidemiology and looking for links with other domains that could kind of help genomic epidemiology offer more of a value add by combining with digital epi and combining with One Health than it could offer on its own. So this is sort of, I'll give you the heavily pictorial fun version of this article, but if you do want to dig into it more, that is available. So let's start, let's dive in. And let's dive in by hopping into our time machine, our sweet little DeLorean here, and taking a trip back into what I describe as the pandemic lessons learned literature. Every time there is a major infectious disease event, in the wake of that, there will be a ton of articles published, a ton of white papers written, a ton of reports put out by various think tanks and institutions talking about what are the lessons that we learned from this pandemic. And so I was curious, you know, in the wake of the West African Ebola epidemic, started to wonder, you know, where did all these lessons learned papers come from? I was sitting on a National Academies committee that was exploring some of the origins of that Ebola outbreak. And yeah, it got me thinking, like, where were the first lessons learned reports? And the first one that I could find in PubMed actually goes back to 1919 and the influenza outbreak. This is George Soper, a legendary figure in public health for many, many reasons, many, many accomplishments. But he was writing in Science way back when on the lessons of the Spanish influenza pandemic. And at the time, in this sort of very first lessons learned paper, because the science was so new, the lessons learned were like, hey, we should pay attention to respiratory viruses and figure out, you know, like what's going on with these things. We should understand them better. So kind of cool, pretty straightforward. Nice work, George Soper. If you get back in your time machine, head a little bit forward, the next paper that I was able to dig up came in the wake of the 1958 H2N2 influenza epidemic. This was written by Mac Shanholtz. And here is where you start to see the trends that still carry on to this day in that lessons learned literature. This is where they start to appear. This is where you see things talking about, for example, health systems. You know, future epidemics can be handled better if communities are organized. If you've got local health groups working together, you really need cooperation. And he also, in this article, gives what I think is the first recorded appearance of pandemic lessons learned hubris, where you start to say things like, oh, we learned a lot from this experience. This is really going to help us next time around. And if you go back and you look at all the pandemic lessons learned literature after this point, this theme of, hey, we learned a lot from this particular experience, this is going to help us next time, this theme pops up time and time again. For example, one of the first epidemics that I was really, really interested in, it occurred when I was, about 2 years into my PhD, and a team just down the road from where I was studying at the BC Genome Sciences Center was actually involved in the first genome sequencing of the original SARS coronavirus. This was the 2003 SARS outbreak. And this, if any of you are big infectious disease outbreak nerd fans, you might recognize this hotel. It's been renamed, but this was the infamous Hotel Metropolitan, where viral super spreading and super shedding was sort of first realized and that acted as a springboard for SARS cases spreading from Hong Kong to around the world. But again, you know, you look at the lessons learned papers after SARS, and you see things, again, this hubris appearing, hey, this has better prepared the world for the anticipated and much feared next real pandemic. I don't think I need to tell you that that hasn't necessarily been the case. I mean, this screenshot is a couple days old at this point, but whether it was Ebola in West Africa, where we hadn't seen it before, whether it was Zika in South America, where we hadn't seen it before, whether it was SARS-CoV-2, COVID-19, that we hadn't seen before anywhere, we were not prepared. And interestingly, the sense that, hey, maybe we don't know what we're doing when it comes to pandemic response and pandemic preparation and prevention, that was starting to creep into the literature around the time of the West African Ebola outbreak. I think that one was a real wake-up call for the infectious disease community that we aren't very well equipped to deal with these situations. And you started to see that hubris disappearing out of the literature and instead being replaced by this much more realistic view that, don't really know what we're doing. So what I'm going to put forward in the rest of this presentation and what I talk about in that article with Nick Lohman is just one of many potential solutions, I think, to get us to a place where we can be better prepared for the next pandemic. You know, the goal is really being able to find an outbreak early, being able to contain that outbreak early, and take any little sparks and sort of quash them, extinguish them before they can spread into a real wildfire. And there are so many parts of the system that you need to be functioning in order for that to take place. I mean, this is everything from strengthening primary healthcare and basic health systems, all the way through to really strong community engagement, social and behavior change work. You need a lot of things in a lot of places, but I think one of those things could be this notion of digital pathogen surveillance. And as I said off the top, digital pathogen surveillance really sort of pulls three ideas together. There is genomic epidemiology, which I spent a ton of my life working on. There's digital epidemiology, which is an area I've sort of dabbled in, but have collaborated frequently with folks who are absolute experts in this area and I find super, super interesting. And then the concept of One Health, which I think provides sort of a nice wrapper for the whole thing. So in the rest of the presentation, I'll kind of take you through each of those things, particularly genomic and digital epidemiology, and at the end, kind of give you a sense for how those might pull together. And just as a little teaser, by the end of the presentation, you will also see one of the worst drawings I have ever made, but I think it does communicate a really good complex subject, but it's terrible. So stay tuned for my bad art skills. And I will, before I dive into the technical explanations, just do a little a caveat or a statement of position. Many years ago, Ed Yong, who's one of my favorite science journalists and who's been doing an exceptional job of reporting on the COVID-19 pandemic, he wrote this article back in 2017, very prescient. He said, is it possible to predict the next pandemic? He was writing about groups like EcoHealth Alliance, the Predict Project, the Global Virome Project, who are all friends of mine. Indeed, I sit on the advisory board for the Global Virome Project. But there's a group of folks that said, we should be able to predict the next pandemic. So Ed wanted to go out and say, like, is this really possible? So he talked to a number of folks, myself included, and most of us fall squarely on the pandemic prediction skeptic side. I think it's just far too complex and intractable a problem. As you'll see later, you know, myself and my colleagues really strongly believe that you can detect outbreaks early, you can detect clusters early and contain them, but trying to predict those things before they happen is next to impossible. So everything I will show you is sort of through this lens of me being very skeptical about the possibility of preventing a pandemic, but very, very bullish on the idea that, you know, if we can identify clusters early, contain them early, we can stop something small, something, you know, like a tiny spark from blowing up into a wildfire. So let's walk through the technical bits and pieces. We'll start with genomic epidemiology because it's the thing that I know the most about. So let me walk you through, if you haven't done any sort of molecular epidemiology and particularly, you know, molecular epidemiology within the context of a public health agency, how you go about identifying an outbreak is through a combination of different information streams. So the first is you will always have surveillance systems running. And in a place like British Columbia, where I worked, in a place like San Francisco, where many of you are dialing in from today, there are a number of different surveillance systems. There are reportable communicable diseases that laboratories and clinicians have to report on regularly to a public health agency. So there's counts of cases, testing data. There is syndromic surveillance. You know, in British Columbia, for example, if you are a physician and you want to get paid for seeing somebody, you have to put a billing code on saying, oh, I saw this patient for influenza-like illness. And that information is entered into the system basically daily. So you can look at peaks and changes in billing codes. There's a number of different surveillance systems that are out there, all turned on. So when a surveillance system picks up a higher than normal number of cases of a particular disease in a particular area over a particular time frame, that will usually trigger an epidemiological investigation, the second step of which is often a molecular epidemiology approach. So if, you know, jump back to this, say we've got, you know, 20 cases of salmonella that are picked up in a region over a week, and we would ordinarily expect maybe 5 cases or 10 cases, our epis might say, okay, well, let's do pulse field gel electrophoresis on all of those 20 samples. And maybe they find that, I don't know how many are here, 7 samples, maybe they find 7 of them are identical. They have the same molecular epidemiological fingerprint. And so that really helps you identify a cluster. And it's your, well, here's my little CSI slide. Same things, same principles are being used in molecular epidemiology as you would use, you know, when you're talking about DNA analysis on a crime show, or when they're, you know, Maury Povich, you are not the father episodes. Same technique, basically the same thing. We're just doing it on bacteria, or we're doing it on viruses or parasites like Plasmodium. Same principle. So once you've got these sort of matches, once you've got these clusters identified, you have to send in your field epidemiologists. And they're the ones who, through their contact investigations, which sort of vary in style and a methodological approach depending on the pathogen in question, they go out, ask a bunch of questions, and try and figure out how did a disease transmit, who transmitted to whom, or what transmitted to whom. They're the ones that are trying to connect the dots. And the problem with this sort of current method, where you're using molecular fingerprinting techniques like pulse field gel electrophoresis, multi-locus VNTR analysis, multi-locus variable number tandem repeats, for example, all of these current kind of fingerprinting methods, they only tell you that you've got a cluster of cases. They can't connect the dots. They can't tell you who transmitted to whom. You really need the field epi information for that. There are a variety of different fingerprinting techniques that are out there, and who belongs to your cluster and how many cases are in your cluster is going to depend on the typing method that you've used. So I spent a decade working on tuberculosis, and at one point our lab switched from using basically a 12 locus fingerprinting technique to a 24 locus fingerprinting technique. And with that higher resolution, when we were looking at more information, all of a sudden things that we thought were large clusters suddenly fragmented into a number of much smaller clusters. So it's very sort of technique dependent. And at the end of the day, really, you do need to go out and do that field epi work to be able to draw those arrows, connect the dots, and figure out, you know, exactly where did this outbreak come from, who transmitted to whom. And public health agencies, I don't know if you've ever worked in one, but they are essentially the, out of all of medicine, they are the least well-funded, even in pandemic times. It is really hard to have the financial and the personnel resources to investigate every cluster of everything interesting, especially in, for example, the foodborne illness world, where outbreaks are detected on a daily basis. So we just don't always have the resources to be able to do that sort of work. And yeah, at the end of the day, when you are doing a DNA fingerprinting technique, when you're only looking at a portion of a pathogen's genome, you're not getting all the available information. I kind of liken it to if you had a photo and you took away, you know, 99% of the pixels, you might still have sort of a rough idea of, hey, there's an image here. Hey, it's a black thing. Hey, it's sort of ovally shaped. It's only when you look at all of the available information, all the pixels, that that picture really snaps into focus. So genomic epidemiology is basically the notion of, hey, why do molecular fingerprinting, basic DNA fingerprinting analyses, when you could be doing whole genome sequencing? Why look at a fraction, you know, less than 0.1% in some cases of an organism, of a pathogen's available genome, when you could be looking at 100% of the genome, when you could be looking at 100% of the pixels and getting a really clear high resolution picture? So when I talk about genomic epidemiology in the bacterial pathogen sense, in the viral pathogen sense, in the reconstructing outbreak sense, it really is taking an outbreak or an epidemic's worth of pathogen genome sequences, reading them in their entirety, and using that information to make inferences about how an infectious disease transmitted in a community. The type of work that I spent a decade doing was really fine-grained outbreak reconstruction, figuring out individual person-to-person transmission events. I was working on tuberculosis and understanding exactly how a TB outbreak unfolded and what are the characteristics, whether those are clinical, demographic, social network characteristics of people that transmitted TB versus people that didn't. That was what I was interested in finding out. How can we use genomics to learn more about who does and doesn't transmit TB so that we can turn that into better programmatic decision-making, better TB policy, better TB care guidelines in British Columbia and Canada and similar settings. So the work that I was doing, I often kind of explained it like the kids' game of telephone, where a teacher will like sit a bunch of kids in a line, the teacher will whisper a sentence to the first kid in line, who whispers it to the next kid, to the next kid, to the next kid. Sentence reaches the end of the line, kid at the end says what they heard, the teacher says what the original sentence that they whispered to that first kid was, and then ha ha ha, everybody laughs because the sentence is different. It is mutated as it is spread from kid to kid to kid. And pretty much exactly the same thing is happening with a pathogen's genome as it's spreading from person to person over time and space in an outbreak. So the idea of genomic epidemiology for outbreak reconstruction is basically analogous to if you played this telephone game with a bunch of kids, and then after the sentence had gone from kid to kid to kid, you just said, hey, kids, just scramble yourselves around the room, go anywhere. And you asked each kid, you know, like, what sentence did you hear? What sentence did you hear? What sentence did you hear? And they tell you, and from what they told you, you try to figure out the order that they were sitting in. So if, you know, there was, say the sentence was like, the cat eats mice, and then it changes to, by the end of the line, it changes to the bat eats rice. You'll be able to, there's two mutations in there, so you'll be able to group kids into cat kids and bat kids. So all the cat ones were probably sitting in one part of the line, all the bat ones were sitting in one part of the line. And within one of those groups, that mice to rice transition would have happened as well. So you can further subdivide that group. So from those small changes, who has mutations in common, you can start to reconstruct the order that the kids were sitting in. Yes, it helps to have epi information like, you know, Timmy always wants to sit next to Tommy, or like Susie and Jane are fighting this week, so they definitely wouldn't be sitting next to each other in the line. When you've got that epi information, it makes that genomic information even easier to interpret. And you can generally, if you've got high quality genomics and you've got high quality epi information, combine the two into a real good reconstruction. So we were sort of the first group to do this, really. It seems like a long time ago. I started working on that project in 2009, and we published a New England Journal paper on it, sort of the first big outbreak reconstruction in 2011. And it really just blossomed out from there, with next generation sequencing making it so easy and cheap and quick to sequence multiple isolates, whether they're bacterial, whether they're viral, from an outbreak situation. You really started to see this technique take off around the world. And I don't think I need to tell anybody here that it has been one of the most useful things in the current COVID-19 pandemic. I mean, genomics was obviously the thing that helped us pinpoint, okay, what is this new strange SARS-CoV-2 virus? early on in the outbreak, Trevor Bedford, who was just recognized both with a MacArthur Genius Grant and a HHMI Howard Hughes Medical Institute investigatorship, he used the Next Strain platform that he and Richard Nair have developed to do some of the earliest tracking of what was happening with, first of all, the first samples coming out of China. This is data that was collected just in the first 2 months of the outbreak. And on Next Strain, Trevor and his team were really easily able to pinpoint interesting events like a household transmission, for example, where it was 100% identity between the two SARS-CoV-2 genomes. So really early on helping to establish like, okay, what's the mutation rate? How many changes would expect in two viral genomes from a direct transmission event? Early on, they were able to use genomic information to date the most recent common ancestor of what was then just called the 2019 nCoV or novel coronavirus. This was before it got its official SARS-CoV-2 designation, but using different mutation rates, they were able to look at when was the probable emergence of this virus, basically November 2019. And one of Trevor's big, I think this is where he really kind of jumped into the spotlight, and the spotlight has never left him since then, was when the Seattle area, Trevor does work in Seattle at the Fred Hutch, was home to some of the first cases of COVID-19 in the United States. Trevor's team was able to access those samples, sequence those earliest samples, and in a really nice blog post, there was a big story on this in the New York Times. So Trevor is sort of in the blog post, expanded a lot on the science. So if people were interested in the New York Times story, they could kind of go in and see, all right, you know, how did this really unfold? But Trevor was able to, with those early genome sequences, determine that the earliest sample that they got from Washington State, which they've coded WA1 here, versus the second sample from the second detected case that was many, many weeks later, with the amount of mutations that had accrued between those two samples, it was clear that there had been cryptic transmission. There'd been ongoing undetected transmission of this virus in the Seattle, King County, Everett, and Snohomish County area. So this, and you can see the New York Times headlines there, was one of the earliest windows into, okay, this thing's actually been spreading undetected for at least the last couple of weeks. So genomic epidemiology has, I think, really blossomed. I mean, this, as I said, it was something that after we kind of helped set some of the first studies up, you started to see some early adoption for things like foodborne illness, tuberculosis, hospital-acquired infections, a lot of bacterial work. But this was the first real hardcore emergency situation where public health agencies really had to get behind this particular data type. So what you're seeing now all over the world. I just grabbed the screenshot a few days ago, but there's representation from all over the world included in Next Strain. In the US, CDC is leading the SPHERES consortium, which includes a number of federal labs, state labs, academic institutions, even industry and sequencing companies. They're all sequencing routinely. In the UK, the COG UK consortium is, I think, probably doing one of the best jobs around the world of sequencing large numbers of samples in real time and making the data publicly available and very, very easy to work with. And happily, I will say a lot of this is Gates Foundation supported work, but Africa CDC is also now contributing in a really, really meaningful and important way to the global SARS-CoV-2 genomic epidemiology picture, with about 50,000 sequences almost sequenced, particularly over the last 6 to 8 months. So genomic epidemiology is a really exciting tool for understanding disease transmission. And with portable DNA sequencing technologies, this is something that you can do anywhere. I mean, if you go back to that Africa CDC slide, many of these were done on the Oxford Nanopore MinION, which is that tiny instrument that you see plugged into this laptop. This is a photo that came from Nick Lohman's team. This is Raymond, who is a lab technician that they were working with in West Africa during the 2014-15 Ebola outbreak. Raymond is sitting there at a desk with this MinION plugged into the USB port on his computer, and he is sequencing full Ebola virus genomes. And this was work that was being done towards the end of that outbreak to really characterize flare-ups. So that sort of portable DNA technology means that, you know, yes, as you see on the right, this is Christian Happy at his lab at Redeemer's University in Nigeria. Yeah, you can have really big, sophisticated labs that are churning out, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of these sequences in a week. But you can also have what you see on the left, smaller groups. This is the Tackling Infections to Benefit Africa or TIBA group in Botswana. And they've got, you can see it there, it's a little laptop with a little MinION sequencer plugged in, and they're sequencing and analyzing and publicly releasing SARS-CoV-2 genomes as well. So I think it really points towards a future where sequencing is democratized and genomic epidemiology becomes something that we can do really near to source. Here is one of the bad pictures that I'm going to show you in this talk. So like I said, that article that Nick and I wrote was in one of the Nature Reviews family journals. Nature Reviews, they have their own art department, and they say, well, just give us a little sketch of what you want to kind of have in your picture, and our artists will take care of it. So this piece of crap is what I sent them to illustrate what Nick and I think is really sort of a future model for sequencing in outbreak response. They did a much better job of it, but here you've got an example of a little mobile medical unit. This could be set up anywhere. And you've got a team where samples are being collected from patients, they're being processed on the spot, they're being analyzed with highly portable genome sequencers, and they're being turned into actionable reports, whether that's for a clinician or whether it's for an epidemiologist investigating a cluster. I will also, I'm not going to talk about any of these in great detail because it's worthy of an entire conference, and we don't have that, but all of those little bullet points you see there are all the challenges associated with this. You know, I presented the rosy vision, but there's a lot of things that complicate being able to do this and get reliably good data out. These are issues that we're dealing with all over the world right now when it comes to SARS-CoV-2 sequencing, but certainly I think the biggest challenge, if I had to pick one off of this slide, it would be over there on the far right, action. How do you take genomic information and turn it into actionable information that a clinician, that an epidemiologist, that a public health agency can look at and go, aha, I know what course of action to take. Nevertheless, I think genomic epidemiology is really a technology that is here to stay, and it is proving to be certainly one of the workhorses of the COVID-19 pandemic, but also something that is now really well integrated into regular public health laboratory systems. So I'll go back to that Ed Yong article about predicting the next pandemic and go to another quote in here from my friend Christian Anderson, who works in San Diego. He's at the Scripps Institute. Christian is a fantastic virologist and immunologist who's been doing absolutely superb work on a huge array of viral genomic epidemiology use cases. And what I like about this quote from Christian is it gets at that idea that I suggested earlier. He's like, you can't predict a pandemic, but you can really detect the first cluster of cases. So with genomic epidemiology, you can, once you've detected that first cluster of cases, you've determined that it's a cluster. You've sequenced it and you'd be like, oh, yeah, these things are related to each other. This is definitely a cluster. You might have figured out, you know, maybe it's your origins, some early transmission patterns, start to make some inferences about when it jumped into a population. This is cool. This is really neat. It can help us identify clusters. But we have a really big planet. And these clusters, these small clusters, little outbreak sparks that could become pandemic fires, are happening everywhere all the time. So where do we turn our genomic epidemiology lens to? Where should we be looking to find these things? And that's really where the second piece of this digital pathogen surveillance recipe comes in, which is digital epidemiology, and really using this idea of digital epi as an early alert system. So as I said earlier, this is just an excuse to put a cat picture on the screen. Surveillance systems in a place like San Francisco basically involve, you know, automated reporting of case reports, positive lab tests, et cetera. You've got a team of surveillance analysts who are sitting there with, you know, R or Stata or SAS who are looking for blips. And if they see a blip, they're like, okay, something's happening. We need to trigger an outbreak investigation. So if you're lucky, if you're working in a very well-resourced setting, you're getting automated data in and you've got scripts and trained analysts who can look for blips in that. But traditional surveillance systems certainly don't exist all over the world. Surveillance systems are of wildly varying quality depending on where you go on this planet. And most of the places that interesting infectious diseases emerge from are places where there aren't particularly strong surveillance systems. However, no matter where you go in the world, pretty much everybody has the internet. You might not have a great disease surveillance system, but you sure as heck have a mobile phone that you're able to access information, do mobile payments, send text messages, you know, load up news stories, etc. So digital epidemiology is all about saying, okay, outside of traditional public health surveillance systems, can we look at the digital footprints that we as humans leave behind and find interesting clues, bits of information in there that can point us towards potential disease events? The first real big digital epidemiology project was Google Flu. Very simple idea. You know, when people get sick, one of the first things they do is consult Dr. Google, type in their symptoms, like, what is this? So Google engineers thought to themselves, well, hey, you know, if people are getting sick with flu, they're probably typing in, you know, flu symptoms, flu-related search terms and words. So why don't we just look at the volume of search queries that we're getting that have flu-like or flu-associated words in them. And they found that people's search queries for flu words generally mirrored CDC-reported flu activity in an area. The two systems generally tracked fairly well. They tracked well for a while. The algorithm kind of went off the rails after a couple of years for reasons I can get into another time. But it was the first real good proof of concept that, hey, in people's digital traces that they leave behind from their everyday lives, there might be interesting information that can signal a potential disease event. And so digital epidemiology was really kind of born with this. There's been a number of super cool papers in the area. I won't talk about this one in great detail. I do want to throw it up on the screen, though, because it's one that I just think is super cool. Very briefly, this is one that uses people's combined Google search history plus their location as pinged by their mobile phone to identify restaurants that are potentially associated with foodborne illness. So basically, people are looking on their phones, they're going to, you know, the CDC's page about salmonella, or they're going to the Mayo Clinic's page about food poisoning. Google's able to identify people that are querying things that might suggest they have a foodborne illness. And then from their location history, they're able to go back and see if that person's phone was in the vicinity of a restaurant. And if they find a cluster of people who are both searching for symptoms and have their phones indicating that they had been at a particular restaurant, it pings the local public health department to say, hey, this might be a place worth investigating. Super interesting stuff. Also shows that Google is watching you wherever you go. But really, I think the grandparent of digital epidemiology, the really big effort is something called healthmap.org, started by a fellow Canadian, John Brownstein. He's been for many years in Boston, Massachusetts, but this is, I think, one of the coolest resources out there. HealthMap regularly combs a number of websites, public health websites, news media sites, all sorts of things, social media channels, et cetera. And it is constantly pulling in information, scraping it, using natural language processing to look for signals that might indicate an infectious disease event, and then grouping that information, publishing sort of outbreak reports and disease alerts, and really helping people to identify events that might be happening near them. Healthmap.org, anybody can access this information. And John's work has really been, I think, quite seminal in the field of digital epidemiology and has led to a number of very, very cool offshoots. I am not going to try and explain any of those. Genomic epi, that's my bag, but I will leave it to John to talk about digital epidemiology. If you are interested in learning more about this, he gave an absolutely fantastic talk for the Medical Library Association on how digital epidemiology is being used in the COVID-19 pandemic. The link to it is there. I'll just leave it up for a second in case you want to write it down. I do highly recommend watching this if you're interested in this area, because truly, you know, John is the master. So digital epidemiology is one of those tools that can help you figure out where this first, you know, cluster of cases is. When there's a signal, digital epidemiology is likely to pick it up. Some aspect of how we live our lives and how we leave digital footprints behind us on the internet is likely to contain clues or signals that a disease event is happening. So digital epi says, whoa, something's happening. Genomic epidemiology is what you go in with once you know something's happening and you're like, okay, exactly what sort of something is happening and how is this something spreading and how might we contain this something? So detect that first cluster of cases. Next part of this sentence from this Ed Young article is going to segue to the last short part of this presentation, which is talking about, well, where do we look? So Ed says, okay, let's detect the first cluster of cases. That is possible if you are routinely searching for things in people that live at disease fault lines, that live at the places where these diseases are most likely to emerge. Because digital epidemiology is great. You know, HealthMap is constantly scanning everything, everywhere. But you know, it's simple Bayesian prior probabilities that there are certain parts of the world that are more likely to lead to a new infectious disease event than others. So we need to be able to train our resources, train our attention on those areas so that when we do detect that first cluster of cases through digital epi, we can get the genomics in really quickly and start working to characterize this thing. So when it comes to figuring out where the heck do we look, that's where this third piece of the equation, the idea of One Health, comes into play. Because One Health is really all about the fact that, you know, animal health, human health, environmental health, and conditions are all so tightly interlinked. We know that the vast majority of emerging infectious diseases are zoonotic in origin. So we can look to animal populations. We can look to animal populations in areas of changing environment use and changing land use, and know that those are likely to be the hotspots. So One Health can kind of help us direct these digital and genomic epi tools in a way that is most likely to yield signal instead of noise. It would be great if when a new infectious disease emerged into the world, it came with a birth announcement, like, congratulations, you got a brand new baby pathogen, but they generally don't. So instead of, you know, waiting for a big like, ta-da, I'm here, we can be proactive about looking for those new events, those new spillovers in the places where they are most likely to happen. And fortunately, we kind of know where to look. It turns out that there are a number of factors that are relatively easily measured that when combined make an area more likely to be a spillover hotspot. Some of those factors are related to animals. So is there a lot of biodiversity? Is there a lot of contact between humans and wildlife populations or humans and sort of intermediary or secondary hosts? We also know that these are areas often where there is changing land use. For example, people raising what was jungle or forest area and turning it into farmland or land to raise livestock on. And we also know that diseases are likely to spill over and go undetected and start to spiral out of control in areas where there isn't a really strong functioning health system. So places where, you know, civil wars or other sorts of unrest or just general breakdowns in the healthcare system have meant that it's sort of like a sieve that things can pass through easily. So we sort of know where we should be looking. So I'm going to show this picture briefly, and then I'm going to show you the really bad picture that I mentioned at the top of the presentation. Because this, in the Nature article, is the picture that's supposed to kind of bring it all together. Like, hey, let's put this one health bow on digital and genomic epi. And like, they did a fine job. The art department, it's fine. It's fine. But I still think my version better sort of reflects the complexity and the like the feedback loops. So I'm going to go with my version, which is on a single 8.5 by 11 piece of paper in ballpoint pen, sketching out a version for what that sort of future pandemic preparedness surveillance system looks like. You've got, you know, in the bottom right, for example, a farmer. You can tell he's a farmer because he's got a hat and he's got some very weird pigs and some chicken type things. There's things flying over his farm that are maybe birds, there may be bats, maybe they're both, but you can be sampling there. You can be looking at, oh, you know, hey, what is happening in these pigs' noses? What's happening in these chickens' noses? What's happening in the runoff from that particular farm? What if that farmer then gets ill one day? Goes to the doctor. His virus that he's come down with is sampled. It gets entered into a database. Maybe there's local media that's like, oh, hey, we got a bunch of sick farmers or something strange in this area that ends up on healthmap.org. All of a sudden, data are starting to get out there in the community. Scientists are starting to figure out and talk to each other. Okay, something's going on here. You can tell there's a bunch of scientists up there because they've got laptops in that upper right corner and they're asking a bunch of questions and they're working at a chalkboard. Data are going into genome databases like NextStrain and being made publicly available. You've got this feedback cycle when we start to see interesting events happening. More local study teams are going into the area and generating more interesting data. This is the vision. It would be great if I could just, you know, submit this to a funding agency and be like, here, we should do this. But at the end of the day, this is just a complex, badly drawn way of saying, I think if you bring genomic epidemiology together with digital epi and kind of wrap it all up in that one health bow, have that be one of the sort of guiding principles for all of this, we do have a chance to get better at detecting interesting clusters of cases early. We have a chance of understanding those a lot earlier. And we have a chance of, once we understand those things, being able to actually contain them. So with that, I will finish up. I'm going to stop screen sharing. Once I find my mouse, where's my mouse? There's my mouse. Yay, screen sharing is stopped. Thank you all for paying attention to this. This was super fun. And let's do some questions. Only the bat starts smiling and a cycloptic bat. This is great.
We're here to give you critical feedback on your on your sketches. So when you do submit it for funding, you can give us like some props for helping you out.
Yeah, totally. You guys can be a sub award on it. The art department and EPPIcenter art department.
All right, Phil, you have your hand up.
Hi, Phil.
Hi, that was fantastic. Really, both entertaining and informative. It's hard to do both. I really want to ask you about why the